Américas Executive Director, Oscar Chacon, who's joining us from Chicago. So I'll hand it over to him. He'll be sharing a bit more about kind of the broad goals and the vision of this collaborative project with so many of the great members who are joining us today. I'll hand it over to you now, Oscar.
Thank you, Nancy, and thank you everyone who's attending, both the panelists who are with me here to speak to you all, and also to you who are attending this event. Let me begin by saying that Alianza Americas has embarked on this ambitious collaborative project because we understand the urgent need that health inequities represent for immigrant communities in the U.S. The pandemic has shed light on the long-standing inequities that impact our life expectancy, our overall health and well-being. We are pleased to be working all together with 21 partners in this undertaking, leading among them the U.S.-Mexico Border Health Commission and the Latino Commission on AIDS. Then we have an array of partners, including Presente.org, Arkansas United in Arkansas, Casa Yurumain in New York, Central American Resource Center of Washington, D.C., Center for Immigrant Progress in Illinois, Centro San Bonifacio, also in Illinois, Comunidades Indígenas en Liderazgo or Cielo in California, COPAL in Minnesota, the Central America Resource Center in Houston, Texas, Familias Unidas en Acción in New Orleans, Louisiana, Hondurans Against AIDS in New York, LILA LGBTQ Initiative in North Carolina, Rural Women's Commission in Florida, Strangers No Longer in Michigan, Telpochcali Community Education Project in Illinois, We Count in Florida, WIN or the Welcome Immigrant Network in Massachusetts, Wind of the Spirit in New Jersey, and Women Working Together also in Florida. So all together, we are reaching out to communities in 13 different states. This is an effort that involved these many organizations because from the beginning of the pandemic, we have been working on the ground to address the needs for information, personal protection equipment, testing, treatment, and vaccination for our communities. This initiative is allowing us to bridge some of the gaps that explain the disproportionate impact of the pandemic on Latin American immigrant communities, Latinx communities in the US. We are reaching populations for whom their mother tongue is not English or Spanish, but indigenous languages from Guatemala, Mexico, and particularly Garifuna language from Black Central Americans. We are also helping immigrants who do not speak English and to be able to seek an appointment and to obtain the vaccines that they need. We are also empowering them to be able to advocate with their local governments for the service and support that they need. We are also working hard to combat misinformation that is definitely widespread, resulting in unsafe behaviors and vaccine hesitancy. We are conveying information on preventive measures. We are also working hard to gain the trust of our communities at all levels. And we are hoping that all this will result in policies that prioritize immigrants and not immigration enforcement. The reason why so many communities are hesitant of local government is because sadly, in the past, immigration enforcement has been far more important than actually serving communities. But I would say that for the most part, what we are doing is reaching out to communities who do not navigate on the web and for whom direct one-on-one contact is the most effective and trustworthy form of communication. They are learning from their community leaders. They are learning about practices that are safe and are important and how important the vaccine happens to be. And we are also creating audio messages, convening virtual events wherever possible in open spaces where we are able to share information and resources and to accompany families in their search for the vaccine, for testing and for treatment. With this project, we are empowering our communities to advocate before their public health officials, to build and strengthen their relationship with local and state authorities, to design and implement public health policies that are inclusive and equitable. We are building a leading learning network to address not only COVID-19, but other infectious diseases and hopefully other relevant health needs in our communities, not only today, but also for the future. So for Alianza Americas, it's a great pleasure to be playing a leading role in this particular undertaking. And I look forward to saying within, you know, time that we have indeed made a difference in the life of our communities by fighting back against health inequities very much exposed in the context of COVID-19 and this global pandemic that we are still fighting. Back to you, Nancy.
Thank you so much, Oscar, for opening up this conversation for us. We'll now hand it over to Luis Scacabarozzi, the Vice President of Latino Commission on AIDS, who's going to share some of the great work that they're doing in partnership on this joint project together. I'll hand it over to you now, Luis.
Well, first of all, Oscar, thanks for your words. Nancy, gracias. You know, it's a pleasure to be part of this initiative, truly needed within, you know, what is the United States. And within the partners, we see that diversity that is also seen throughout the United States, the racial diversity, the ethnic diversity, geographic diversity, and linguistic diversity. So all that is represented within the organizations that are here today. And so that's very important because the messenger matters. It's something that we talk about highly at the Latino Commission on AIDS about how important that is in making sure that the message gets across to the different communities that we are serving. You know, throughout these 14 months, we've seen, as Oscar mentioned, the inequities, the disparities that and how the Latino community has been impacted. And, you know, although we're 18.5% of, you know, the total population of the U.S., we actually represent 34.5% of the deaths and 29.2% of the cases. And this doesn't actually represent the entire numbers because this is only representing, as of late last month, 61% of the total cases. So it's estimated that we actually might be more than that in the total number of deaths and the total number of cases. When we look at the states, you know, throughout the United States, we see some states that have even more disparate impact. You know, we see cases such as Utah or Oregon that might have 13 or 14% of the total population, but then we're looking at 20 to 25% of the total COVID cases, or Washington that has 13% and has 30% of the total COVID cases. California, a large state that has a large Latino population, which has 39.3% of the total population, has almost 56% of the total cases. So we see those disparities and we work with those disparities, not only in what is COVID, but in many of the other illnesses and chronic conditions that many of our organizations have been working with. At the Latino Commission, for much of the work that we do, we kind of look at much of what the Oscar mentioned and Nancy, much of what you have mentioned is what we call the four A's, which is looking at affordability, looking at availability, accessibility, and the awareness that the communities have in regards to the issues needed so that way they can access healthcare services. And that's been very important for us to, in the way we look at the public health issues. You know, we've mentioned that, you know, that COVID vaccines are available, that the testing is available. Many members of our communities aren't aware of that because, you know, either it's linguistic challenges, either it's fears. And part of the work that we're doing is dispelling those fears and making sure that people have that accessibility and are familiar with the availability. And so that's a major part of the work that we're doing is making sure that people are aware and our communities are aware that they have access to all these services. As you mentioned, this is work that's being done beyond English and Spanish. This is, you know, communities that are highly impacted and rarely get that information in their native languages. So again, quite proud to be part of this initiative and looking forward to the work that we have ahead of us. Thank you, Nancy. Back to you.
Thank you so much, Luis, and thank you for all the powerful work you all are doing at the Latino Commission on AIDS. We'll now hand it over to our next panelist and who's also part of this collaborative project, Juanita Lara, who's a program manager at the U.S.-Mexico Border Health Commission. And I'll make note that their work that they're realizing through this project is led by the Mexican section of the U.S. Border Health Commission. I'll hand it over to you, Juanita.
Thank you, Nancy. And I actually made a little presentation for this. So as soon as the slides come up. Thank you. So I just want to say that I echo a lot of what my colleagues at Alianza and Latino Commission on AIDS mentioned. I think this partnership is very important, not just now that we're all in this pandemic, but as a model of how community-based organizations and organizations that represent multiple other organizations can come together to really impact the communities. And by impact, I mean really make a difference in the communities that we all come from, that we all live in, that we all work with. And this just makes me think of me when I was growing up in California, of how important these partnerships really are to reach communities. So in brief, I just wanna talk a little bit about our mobile health and wellness program. It's a project of the Mexico section of the U.S.-Mexico Border Health Commission. And I say Mexico section because there are two distinct offices that operate under this agreement. One is the U.S. side and one is the Mexico side. And it is the Mexico side that's really implementing this particular project. The mobile health units began in 2016 as an effort to expand the services that we provide in our Ventanilla de Salud program, which many of you may or may not have heard. We also oversee a program that operates out of the Mexican consulates across the US called the Ventanillas de Salud. And this mobile health program, our mobile health and wellness program, takes those baseline services and puts them on the road. Next slide, please. As a core of our services in general, even prior to this pandemic, our mobile health units provide guidance and counseling on all types of health-related issues. We provide screenings such as HIV screenings, body mass index, cholesterol, et cetera. We partner with local community health and medical institutions to refer participants to these sites. We do offer some vaccines. Even prior to the COVID-19 vaccine, we offered influenza vaccines or vaccines to children in some of our mobile units. And we provide information on how to apply for health insurance or navigate the medical system in the US, whether you're uninsured or ineligible for health insurance. Next slide, please. We have 11 mobile health units across the US, working out of 11 metropolitan cities. Next slide, please. Our project at its core is a partnership of partners. We aim to improve the health promotion and response activities to limited English proficient Latinx essential workers and their families. And in doing so, we create these partnerships with other organizations and allies to really establish a network of information, viable information that's so important to our communities, and establish a way that we can address the health disparities that we face on various different levels. Next slide, please. Specifically for this project, beginning of this year, we focused on creating and promoting technical content that had been already developed by the CDC, by the Mexican Ministry of Health, and by other sources that are trusted and viable around the COVID-19, the vaccine, and around mental health services. Next slide, please. Some of these principal activities included new printed materials that are visuals. Lots of folks like myself are a visual learner. So if I can have a document that can tell me information about this vaccine, about how to protect myself, I'm more likely to read it and absorb it. But more importantly, our mobile units have promotoras that explain this information to the community that come and we offer services to. So that relationship building is also a very important component. Next slide, thank you. Our principal activities in March and April as well included an element of mental health. And in our experiences in this last year, what we saw in our communities was the trauma that this pandemic provided for many of our communities, the trauma of not only just becoming contagious of this or contracting this COVID-19 virus, but also spreading it, but also the loss of employment, the loss of home, the loss of family. And we realized that we needed to prepare our promotoras to really face the mental health aspect of what this pandemic is bringing with, so that we can provide more important information. Additionally, our 11 mobile sites provided through social media a lot of their activities. They provided information through Facebook, all types of social media platforms to really share with their communities. Next slide, please. And for the last two slides, what I wanted to share was just a very quick snapshot of what the start of this year means for our mobile health units. As a general service, including all types of other services, our mobile health units have reached over 148,000 individuals. And these are cumulative with all of our 11 sites, providing over 1,000,001 services, including screenings and vaccines and referrals. Next slide, please. Specifically for the COVID-19 events, we've already seen over 680 people provided all kinds of information on our social media. And right now what we're focusing most on is the testing, aside from developing new ways that we can provide the vaccine as well. And what I wanna highlight here is the importance of how this network, in addition to working in collaboration with Alianza and Latino Commission on AIDS, we really can reach these, and I hate to say it, but hard to reach communities are not really that hard to reach. It's that they're untargeted, and efforts to really target our communities are lacking, and we've seen and we're experiencing what a lack of that attention really does to our communities. So partnerships such as these and programs such as the Mobile Health Unit really are effective in providing information and access to vaccines so that we can combat this pandemic that we're in together. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Juanita, for your great work at the commission. And now we'll be moving on to our panelists, who are Alianza America's member organizations. And our first panelist up from that list is Selena Forbes with Hondureños Contra el SIDA, or Hondurans Against AIDS, coming to us from Bronx, New York. Selena, adelante.
Mm-hmm. Good afternoon to everyone. My name is Selena Guevara from Hondurans Against AIDS, located in the Bronx. We have been working closely with our Garifuna community, with the trying to educate them against the spread of and the virus of the COVID-19. We have been doing referrals and helping them with appointments. And during this time in the work that we have been doing, we encountered the issue that between our community, there are some people that are afraid. They feel afraid because they think, because of their immigration status, that they will not be able to get a vaccine. So we have been educating them and letting them know that it doesn't matter their education, that their immigration status, that the vaccine is available to everyone. We have been also accompanying them to the vaccine center. We had a group that we went with them to the vaccine center and they got their vaccine. And they are helping us spread the word that even though that of their immigration status, they were able to get the vaccine. Thank you.
Thank you, Selena. And I'll pause real quickly here. I might have not mentioned at the beginning, we are going to be opening up questions and answers for reporters who are attending today after everyone speaks. So you can definitely put in your questions in the Q&A or the chat, and we can address them after everyone speaks. Thank you so much for sharing, Selena.
You're welcome.
And now next up is Carolina Ortiz from Copal in Minnesota. Carolina, adelante.
Gracias, Nancy. And thank you for allowing me to be part of this conversation today. So at Copal, which is located in Minnesota, it has definitely been a hard time for our community, especially after the arrival of COVID-19, as far as resources and getting information to our community, mm-hmm. Something that I really, I thank you, Juanita, for mentioning is some of the hard to reach quote unquote places are just not on top of the list locally as part as a priority. So some of the things that we have been doing locally in Minnesota, working with counties, local counties, as well as local clinics, is having vaccine events in some of the places where people don't usually see Latino organizations or people talking Spanish, and really helping them through the process. In order to be able to communicate with our community, we have also designated a hotline where people can call us. They know we speak Spanish. They know that we can register them over the phone. They don't have to worry about having access to either a computer, having access to knowing how to fill out the form. We do it all for them. And another thing, as Oscar also mentioned at the beginning, that one-on-one is really crucial, especially for our Latino community. So we go directly to them. We go to their workplaces, to Latino supermarkets. We go to places where we know that they usually are. And we talk to them. We talk to them about either getting them registered right there for a vaccine, or as we know, sometimes there's also hesitation as far as getting the vaccine. So it's also a great opportunity to say, hey, you know, if you haven't gotten your vaccine, here's some information. If you need to call our hotline and get more information in order to know whether you will get vaccinated or not, here's the information. So that has really played a big part in gaining the trust from our community, as well as making sure that our numbers continue to grow as far as vaccination here in Minnesota. So that's just a little bit of the work that we've been doing, but I send it back to you, Nancy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carolina, and for Copal's, all of your amazing work through this project. Next up, we're going to have Karen Blanco of Casa Yurumein in the Bronx, New York as well. Adelante, Karen.
Gracias, Nancy. Como Casa Yurumein en el Bronx, Nueva York, actualmente estamos enfrentando desafíos sobre la desinformación de la vacuna Johnson & Johnson. Luego de las noticias sobre los efectos secundarios sobre la vacuna, nuestra comunidad está temerosa de vacunarse. Nosotros estamos haciendo esta labor de educación. Como ha confirmado la CDC, la mayor parte de los efectos secundarios de la vacuna Johnson & Johnson no son graves y los beneficios superan con creces y es beneficioso para toda nuestra comunidad. Otra labor que estamos haciendo es que estamos llegando a las personas de nuestra comunidad que solo se comunican en nuestro idioma garífuna. Para entender el desafío del idioma, para hacer esto, estamos trabajando de la mano con nuestros jóvenes que se han convertido en nuestros voceros. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias por compartir, Karen, qué gran trabajo que están haciendo a través de, pues, de su organización en su comunidad. Ahora, sorry, going back to English. Next, we'll have Leticia Casildo from Familias Unidas en Acción from New Orleans. Adelante, Leticia.
Bueno, buenas tardes. Creo que hago un eco, ¿no?, de todo lo que las barreras que nuestras compañeras han mencionado. Pero abundando a esto, una de las cosas que nosotros hemos tenido aquí como desafío es a veces los horarios de las vacunas o los lugares de las vacunas que son un poco inaccesibles para nuestra comunidad, reconociendo de que ellos pues trabajan a veces en los horarios que se están poniendo las vacunas. Entonces lo que hemos hecho es tratar de buscar espacios donde puedan haber horarios accesibles, como es en las horas de la tarde, cuando la gente ya ha salido de su trabajo. Información importante que damos en el idioma, porque nosotros aquí no solamente hablamos español, inglés, garífuna. También hay otros idiomas que son a veces no muy conocidos, como el achi. Entonces hacemos algunos videos para poder enfocar y decirle a la gente dónde están los espacios de vacunación y cómo podemos hacer para que esas vacunas que nosotros no podemos llegar a veces, sino que las vacunas puedan ir donde están los espacios de nuestra comunidad. Entonces, es mucho que estamos haciendo por aquí, pero eso es parte de lo poquito que puedo compartir ahorita. Gracias.
Muchas gracias, Leticia, y qué gran trabajo que están impulsando ahí en Nueva Orleans y en Luisiana. Next up, we're going to have Isai Pasos from Cielo in Los Angeles, California, also doing some great work. Isai, adelante.
Hi, good afternoon or good morning for some of you. Well, thank you very much for having me. I really want to start with thanking Alianza Americas, basically for their partnership. But I also want to say that the community here in LA, we're actually in Los Angeles, California, and we unfortunately have a large community that lacks with, they have a barrier with language. And this is where we come in. We come in with helping them understand, translate their to a native language, which is either could be Zapoteco, Mixteco, Chinanteco, Quiche. So that is what we do. We try to educate them based with videos. We create videos educating them why it is important for them to get vaccinated, what are the symptoms that they might be receiving or getting after getting vaccinated. So that is what we do. That is our work here in LA, to help the indigenous community that unfortunately doesn't understand or has fear of getting vaccinated. Lately, for example, last week, this past weekend, we vaccinated on their second dose over 400 members of the community. And that is very important for us. Important because we have partnered also with clinics that understand the needs that we need, they understand the needs that the community needs. So basically that is the reason why I think partnering with other organizations and clinics is very important. But as I mentioned, I think this coming past weekend was a successful event, because they had many questions of what to do next, when can they go out again, can they still use masks? So that's where we come in and teach them and try to make them not feel weird or fear of what's gonna come up or what's the next stage. One of the other things that we also have done is we've also provided funds for these communities to help them out a little bit. But the most important thing that we're focusing on right now is on their health and also on the fear. So once again, we're going back to animated videos in order to help them out. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Isai, for that great work you're doing the community. It's exciting to hear so many people are getting vaccinated thanks to the great work you all are doing. And up next, we'll have Marisela Ortiz from Strangers No Longer in Michigan. Adelante, Marisela.
Sí, gracias. Buenas tardes. Buenos días para otros, ¿verdad? Mi nombre es Marisela Ortiz y represento a la organización Strangers No Longer de Michigan. Los retos con los que nos hemos encontrado son, primero, pues que la gente está mal informada sobre las vacunas y, por lo tanto, pues la falta de interés, ¿verdad? También algo que ha tenido mucho que ver es pues lo sucedido con las vacunas de Johnson & Johnson, como ya lo compartían antes. Entonces, pues este punto le estamos atacando con las presentaciones que estamos haciendo a través de nuestros promotores, y estamos tratando de concientizar, de informar y de invitar a la gente, a la comunidad, que se sume a este proyecto de vacunación. Por otro lado, el acceso a las vacunas en las áreas rurales es otro obstáculo. La falta de transporte público en estas áreas, aunado con los sitios de vacunación que se encuentran un poco lejos, es uno de los principales problemas que hemos tenido. Y para esto estamos en pláticas con el departamento de Wayne University, el departamento de salud de Wayne University. Ellos tienen un programa de unidades móviles de vacunación y estamos tratando de obtener un día de vacunación y que nos manden una de estas unidades móviles a las áreas rurales, y así que pues estas personas puedan tener acceso a lo que es la vacuna. Esto es lo que les puedo compartir. Como decían, también estamos haciendo más cosas, pero yo creo que esto es lo más importante. Muchas gracias por el espacio y gracias.
Gracias a ti, Marisela, por el gran trabajo que están haciendo en Michigan. And up next, we have Jacqueline Lopez with Women Working Together from Florida, who's going to share a bit about the work that they're leading down in South Florida. Jacqueline?
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Jacqueline López, soy parte de Women Working Together, una organización de mujeres que en su 90% somos trabajadoras del hogar. Hemos estado al pie de la lucha dentro de los hogares trabajando con los mayores, limpiando casas y cuidando niños. Estamos ubicadas en el sur de la Florida, en el condado de Broward y en el condado de Miami-Dade. Nuestro gran desafío fue que la gente tenía problemas para obtener la vacuna porque no tenía una identificación. La gran mayoría no tiene estatus migratorio y no nos valía nuestro certificado de nacimiento ni nada de eso. Entonces, eso ha sido una dura prueba porque la gente quería vacunarse, pero no podía. Nuestros logros, hace como unas 2 semanas, se ha aprobado un ID municipal en el condado de Broward y esperamos que se vaya aprobando en otros condados más, de manera que la gente tenga la seguridad de que le van a vacunar. También hemos estado trabajando en informar y educar a la comunidad mediante cursos, mediante charlas en iglesias, en restaurantes, para que tomen confianza y puedan vacunarse. Y hemos conseguido muchos equipos de la comunidad para hacer las citas, ayudarles en este proceso tecnológico que ha sido una gran barrera para toda la comunidad. Y también llevándoles al lugar, porque muchas personas no tienen auto, esa es nuestra realidad, no tienen licencias, tienen miedo a manejar, los lugares eran un poco lejos, no llegaban los buses en Florida. No tenemos muy buen servicio de buses, entonces era una gran barrera. Entonces, la misma comunidad se ha brindado a prestar sus autos para llevarles al lugar. Y bueno, termino diciendo que para nosotros, nuestra frase que siempre repetimos es una comunidad vacunada, una comunidad sana, una comunidad fortalecida para retornar a la normalidad. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Jacqueline, por el gran trabajo que están haciendo en la Florida. So now the last panelist that will be speaking is Gabriela Miranda from Arkansas United, also doing some amazing work there. Gabriela, adelante.
Thank you, Nancy. Well, hi all. My name is Gabriela Miranda from Arkansas United. And we found that for us, it all comes back to trust. First, as you all know, Arkansas is mostly a rural state and public transportation is almost non-existent in these areas. And another big problem that we have is that in Arkansas, undocumented people cannot get a driver's license. Mm-hmm. And we're trying to solve that problem too, but for now, people are afraid to drive longer distances. And so what we found we need to do is bring vaccines closer to the people via mobile and local clinics and having navigators who are themselves part of the communities they serve and are trusted involved throughout the whole process. In many cases, they are personally calling people to help with the registration and sometimes even driving them directly to the clinics. So that way we were able to get 160 farmers and local workers vaccinated in a local clinic that we organized in the southeast part of the state. But none of this again could have been done without the trust that we build first in the communities. Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you, Gabriela. And that's amazing to hear those numbers and your you know, you're reaching these communities that really need the support. And yeah, thank you so much for your work. Thanks everyone for sharing. Now we'll take a few minutes to get some questions from press. Thanks for your patience. And we have a couple of questions that came in. I think I'll just leave it open for those who want to respond. This is a pregunta para todos, so I'll ask it in Spanish. And this is from Rubén Tapia. ¿Qué tanto se ha avanzado en la vacunación en sus comunidades y qué tanto les falta? Así que los que les gustaría compartir, por favor. Que no les dé pena.
Por ejemplo, en nuestra comunidad garífuna, nosotros hemos logrado avanzar bastante, primero tuvimos que educarlos de que a pesar de su estado migratorio, porque nosotros contamos con una población muy grande de personas inmigrantes sin documentos. Entonces, esa era una población en donde nosotros estábamos teniendo bastante problema para que se vacunaran. Y al poder educarlos de que eso no era una barrera para poder conseguir la vacuna, entonces logramos que muchas personas más se vacunaran. So, nosotros hemos avanzado mucho en ese aspecto y hemos logrado que tengan más confianza también en la vacuna. Tuvimos un problema cuando sucedió lo del Johnson, pero ya después logramos otra vez seguir con el avance que estábamos teniendo anteriormente. So, yo estoy muy feliz que mi comunidad garífuna ahora están más y más poniéndose la vacuna y están dejando el miedo atrás.
Muchas gracias, Selina. Si hay alguien más que quiera responder a la pregunta de Rubén, ¿qué tanto se ha avanzado en la vacunación en sus comunidades y qué tanto les falta?
Yo puedo un poco. Hola, aquí Juanita de la Comisión de Salud Fronteriza. Muchas gracias por la pregunta porque creo que es una muy importante. Nosotros, de nuestras 11 unidades móviles, creo que ya 6 de ellas ya están proveyendo vacunas directamente a la comunidad. Lo están haciendo a través de alianzas con hospitales locales o con sus gobiernos locales, como los departamentos de salud del estado. Y ahorita estamos esperando las últimas 5, creo que van a empezar muy pronto. Muchas de ellas están enfocando sus esfuerzos en trabajadores agrícolas, sobre todo en Arizona, donde hay una población muy grande de trabajadores agrícolas y es donde están saliendo con la unidad móvil a proveer las vacunas. Pues estamos haciendo un esfuerzo muy grande y aunque pues, me enorgullezco en decir que este esfuerzo es por parte de mis agencias de la red que estamos trabajando, pero nos queda mucho trabajo por delante. Esto apenas va empezando, estamos justo en el medio y va a seguir hasta que todos estemos vacunados.
Muchas gracias, Juanita. Le dejo abierta la pregunta para alguien más si quiere, ¿qué tanto ha avanzado en la vacunación, en sus comunidades y qué tanto les falta?
Creo que Luis quería hablar, Nancy.
Ah, perdón, Luis.
No, no te preocupes. Creo que se habla bastante sobre la resistencia y sobre the hesitance en inglés, y no me acuerdo ahorita cómo se dice hesitance, pero creo que también un tema que se ha presentado bastante aquí es lo que en inglés le dicen trustworthiness. Y ahí es donde falta esa información. ¿Y cómo se crea el trustworthiness? Es exactamente esto, es trabajando con agencias que están trabajando directamente con esas poblaciones que necesitamos alcanzar, haciendo llegar información actual, información sobre la seguridad y la eficacia de las vacunas, que a veces falta en español. Y cuando no falta es que no está llegando realmente a las comunidades que necesitan para que tomen esa decisión de ponerse vacuna. So, ese es un tema bastante grande. Nosotros personalmente como agencia no estamos prohibiendo la vacuna, pero trabajamos con organizaciones y tenemos un gran programa que trabaja directamente con las comunidades de fe, que está haciendo ese trabajo en asegurarse de que llegue la información de la mejor manera posible para que ellos también consideren vacunarse. Es una población que no tiene acceso a, muchas veces por ser comunidades inmigrantes, a los mismos servicios que tienen los neoyorquinos, porque hay servicios, pero es hacer llegar la información para que sepan que esos servicios existen.
Muchas gracias, Luis, por la respuesta. Tenemos otra, unas varias preguntas. Voy a seguir con una pregunta de Laura González. La escribió en inglés, así que lo va a leer en inglés. I'm so glad to learn about the work that organizations are doing to support the translation of COVID materials into indigenous communities. Could someone comment on how they assess the effectiveness of translation into indigenous languages? With so many differences in how colonial governments represent present information and how Indigenous communities approach health literacy? How do you make sure that the meaning is transferred into the translations and that translations are effective for Indigenous language speakers? Thank you. Así que, ¿les que quieran? Sí, Isai.
What we've done basically is we actually reached out to community leaders in different counties, not only the LA County, but also, for example, we've also done Northern California, like Salinas, Monterey, Fresno area, Bakersfield, where we know that there's a large Indigenous communities. So what we've done is we reached out to their community leaders because there are the ones that they actually trust on providing information or also telling them, yes, this is a good to go and not to do. And I think what we've done is also we've animated our videos have been animated. So in case there is a variant, because there is also a variant in Indigenous languages, for example, my neighbor community might not understand my language or the meaning of what I'm trying to just to say. But if we see something animated, we get the idea of what we've, you know, trying to explain. And I think what we've done and it has worked a lot for our community is actually animating videos, animating posters, flyers, anything that we uploaded on social media, we try to animate it, but we also try to, get the correct translation. And it is hard. It is hard to get someone, especially there's certain communities out there that maybe we haven't really reached out because maybe there's just a small community or population that resides in LA County or any other county. So what we've done is we try to at least provide them with the help as much as we can. And sometimes we do get other people, like for example, this past weekend, we've got like a person that said, hey, listen, if you need help, I am from this community and I have this other community that I can help out. So that's where, you know, we start interacting. And once again, I think having partnerships is always a welcoming thing. And it's a grateful thing to have because that's the only way that we can make it happen.
Thank you so much, Isai. Does anyone else want to respond to the question regarding from Laura Gonzalez regarding translated materials?
Sí, sí me gustaría aportar un poquito más a lo que Isai está hablando, porque en lo que nos ha pasado a nosotros aquí en el área de New Orleans, porque a veces uno asume de que la comunidad de Guatemala hablan el mismo dialecto, y no es así. Entonces nos ha pasado de que a veces buscando, cuando andamos alcanzando a las personas, como él dice, encontramos a otra persona que habla otro idioma, y esa persona ya se suma al equipo. Entonces hacemos las grabaciones porque creo que son más efectivas que los papeles porque hay gente que no sabe leerlo. O sea, uno allá no le enseñan a veces a escribir. Por lo menos en mi caso, yo nunca aprendí a escribir ni a leer garífuna. Ahora lo estoy aprendiendo. Entonces, ¿de qué sirve un flyer en garífuna si no lo va a poder leer la persona? Entonces, para nosotros es mejor la interacción con la comunidad, hacer los videos y pasarlos de WhatsApp a WhatsApp porque tenemos una red bien grande en esa área. Y eso nos ha servido bastante para poder llegar a la comunidad y poder mantenernos informados y comprender que es lo más importante, ¿no? De qué se nos está hablando y cuál es la instrucción que estamos recibiendo. Y qué mejor, o sea, se siente la tranquilidad de las personas cuando lo reciben de una persona que es como tú. Y eso para nosotros ha funcionado bastante en esta área de acá.
Muchas gracias, Leticia, por eso. Luis, go ahead.
No solamente mencionar, bueno, yo soy peruano, no hablo ni quechua ni aymara, pero son idiomas que se hablan aquí en Nueva York y en Connecticut, en New Jersey. Hay una radio que se llama Radio Quechua, que provee servicios como a 120, 140 mil quechua y aymara hablantes. Entonces, una comunidad bastante grande que se ubica principalmente en ciertas zonas de New Jersey, norte de New Jersey, parte de Connecticut, de Westchester County, que está al norte del Bronx, Queens. Entonces es importante poder trabajar con esas radios, ¿no? Proveerles la información, una información que es actual, correcta y para que ellos puedan compartir con las poblaciones que ellos sirven. Es permitirles que ellos hagan como una adaptación, en inglés un tailoring, de esa información para que ellos puedan compartir con las poblaciones que ellos sirven. So es bastante partnership, es collaboration, y es asegurarnos que esa información llegue a esas comunidades también.
Muchas gracias, Luis, por la respuesta. Tenemos unas cuantas más, así que voy a seguir con las próximas. La próxima pregunta es de Juan Loera, en inglés. Have local health departments or elected officials been helpful in getting the vaccine out to immigrant communities? How have they gotten the message out to these groups, or are they relying on community-based organizations for this? Anyone who would like to respond?
I can tackle that one, at least the beginning. I think it's important to point out that this particular project in many ways is a breakthrough even for the CDC in as far as recognizing the very issue that we were just talking about, namely acknowledging that there are segments within the so-called Latino, Latinx, you know, Hispanic origin communities for whom Spanish is not necessarily their first language. And I would even go as far as saying that it is so important to have people from different nationalities who speak Spanish overall, but there are particular nuances. You know, if you are Colombian, the way you say or call certain things is not the way Salvadoreños do it or the way Mexicans do it, let alone Peruanos, you know, Bolivianos, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So even within Spanish, it's very important to be cognizant of that particular reality. And so we are also, each of us, I mean, taking it upon our own shoulders to educate elected officials, because still many elected officials do not understand the complexities of working with people of Latin American origin. But I think that this is one of the positive side effects, so to speak, of the pandemic. Namely, it is an opportunity to educate not only elected officials, but opinion makers about what has kept our communities in such a situation of disparity when it comes to accessing health services and being healthy. And so this is by no stretch of the imagination the end of anything, but rather the beginning of a task that has been forever and ever been there, but that in many ways the pandemic is opening up opportunities for us to educate and ultimately empower more community actors that are already embedded in these communities, who know these communities, who speak their languages, and who look like them, which I think is very, very important.
Thank you, Oscar. And seeing that we have 10 minutes left, I just want to open this up to see if anyone else would like to tackle this question before we move on to the next. Okay, we'll move on to the next question then. This one's coming in Spanish from Laura Barros. Del porcentaje total de vacunados en Estados Unidos, ¿conocen cuál es el porcentaje de hispanos vacunados? ¿De qué forma la falta de un seguro médico ha sido otra barrera para los hispanos frente?
Perdimos a Nancy, creo. Bueno, pero estaba revisando la pregunta de Laura, si no me equivoco. Tiene que ver, pues, básicamente con el tema de los temores, incluyendo la carencia de seguro médico u otras cosas que han sido barreras para nuestras comunidades. No sé si alguno de ustedes, alguna de ustedes quiere contestar. Sin pena, sin temor.
Bueno, yo puedo comentar un poco acerca de lo que las unidades móviles están reportando. Pues en cuestión de seguro médico como barreras, pues obviamente esta vacuna no se les está pidiendo a nadie, sin importar estatus migratorio, por un seguro y mucho menos por un seguro social, por ejemplo. Sí nos han llegado historias de que hay algunas clínicas que están pidiendo eso como forma para obtener la vacuna. Pero creo que ahora que estamos entrando en un movimiento mucho más activo, tanto de las comunidades como del gobierno federal, como muestra en esta colaboración que estamos haciendo, que ya los esfuerzos están avanzando. Entonces creo que estamos escuchando menos que existen estas barreras, aunque no estoy completamente pues, segura que ya no existe ninguna, ¿no? Sino que pues, estamos avanzando por nuestra parte, en asegurar que las personas se puedan vacunar
Creo que mucho, la siguiente parte de la pregunta como temor de las vacunas, pues todos vamos a tener un temor. Me acuerdo en las conversaciones que tenía con mi propia madre, que se preocupaba acerca de por qué tan rápido desarrollaron esta vacuna y existía ese temor. Pero es simplemente informar a la comunidad. Creo que un esfuerzo grande que estamos haciendo es asegurar que las personas quienes no se han vacunado puedan tener la información pues creíble desde las agencias quienes ellos tienen confianza y que puedan hacer tomar decisiones informadas. Creo que eso es lo más poderoso que podemos hacer, es asegurar que la correcta información le llegue a esas personas y que ellas puedan tomar por su propia voluntad una decisión informada.
¿Alguien más? Adelante, Luis.
Estuve la oportunidad de revisar un poquito la data del CDC y bueno, ellos mencionan que el 12% de las personas que se han hecho las pruebas son latinas. Se ha vacunado. Entonces, si lo vemos de esa manera, estamos bajos, pero yo diría ahí no hay data estatal, lo que significa que pues, no estamos midiendo la cantidad total de personas o latinos que están siendo vacunados realmente, porque puede ser que desproporcionalmente pues latinos están vacunando en gran cantidad en ciertos estados, que puede ser California, quizá Florida, no estoy seguro, Nueva York, pero en otros estados no tanto. Entonces, creo que es cuestión de data, creo que es cuestión de tratar de exigirle de cierta manera a los estados, sobre todo a aquellos estados donde ya hemos visto esas disparidades de salud en cuanto al acceso a servicios, acceso a seguro, y quizás veamos que no somos tanto o somos mucho menos del 12% del total de vacunados. Es mi parecer. Uh-huh.
Quisiera añadir, no sé si alguien más también quisiera añadir algo más, pero solo hacer énfasis en lo último que decía Luis. Uno de los desafíos con COVID a lo largo de la pandemia ha sido que no todas las localidades, no todos los estados han venido sistemáticamente documentando la etnicidad, la raza de las personas afectadas. Y seguimos teniendo ese problema hasta este día, porque no todos los estados están siguiendo el mismo protocolo en cuanto a generación de información. Rubén preguntaba también que cómo veíamos el tema de que se afirma de que muy pronto van a haber muchas más vacunas que brazos dispuestos a que se vacunen. Yo creo que sin duda alguna es un desafío, un buen desafío. Nosotros vamos a hacer todo lo posible para ocupar precisamente la abundancia de vacunas para enfatizar la importancia de que todo el mundo tenga acceso a la vacuna y se vacune. Yo creo que han sido muchos los desafíos que hemos estado tratando de superar. Hay que recordar que para quienes somos inmigrantes en los Estados Unidos, el tema de cualquier tipo de uso de un servicio público en los últimos 25 o 30 años ha tenido muchas connotaciones que generan también temores y no son infundados. O sea, han habido lamentablemente esfuerzos de ocupar el concepto de carga pública para meterle miedo a la gente, para que ocupe servicios a los que tienen derecho a acceder. Y aquí pues entra nuevamente el rol tan importante de las organizaciones comunitarias para precisamente clarificar, literalmente combatir estos malos entendidos para que nuestra gente se vea empoderada de poder tener acceso a lo que necesita. Y aprovecho también para señalar que el sitio web Somos Salud es un sitio web recién bautizado, o sea, acaba de salir, está recién lanzado. La aspiración que tenemos es que se convierta en una plataforma de utilidad para las comunidades a quienes estamos llegando y mucho más allá, porque esas son de las cosas que podemos hacer en el mundo virtual, aunque estamos claros que mucha de la gente a la que nosotros estamos llegándole es población que no necesariamente navega en el internet, no necesariamente se mueve en redes sociales y que precisamente por eso es tan importante el trabajo en el terreno. Así es que no sé, compañeras, compañeros, si alguno de ustedes quiere añadir, nos quedan 3 minutos antes de cerrar. Lamentablemente Nancy quedó sin energía eléctrica en el lugar donde vive, hubo un apagón repentino y por eso no pudo seguir con nosotros. Así es que les invito a todas, si quieren comentar algo más antes de llegar al fin.
Sí, solo quería agregar algo más, Oscar. Tú lo puntualizaste, que a veces la desinformación, como históricamente no tenemos acceso a salud, la gente tiene en su mente que le van a cobrar por ponerse la vacuna. A nosotros nos pasó aquí, a personas que fueron a hacerse la prueba, luego les llegó un bill por hacerse la prueba del COVID. Entonces eso retrocedió, como dicen, yo tengo que pagar $250 porque me hagan la prueba, ¿cuánto me van a cobrar por la vacuna? Entonces ahí es el trabajo que estamos haciendo de llevar la información, que eso es gratis. Nosotros nos comunicamos con la clínica y al final de cuentas pues era un error. O sea, ellos mismos están como automatizados a cobrarle a las personas que no tienen un seguro social. Solo quería agregar eso. Está en mute.
Oscar, no se escucha, está en mute.
My apologies, my bad. Nancy, solo quería saber si ya estabas de regreso con nosotros para devolverte el rol de moderadora.
Sí, muchas gracias, Oscar, y disculpen todos que se me fue la luz de volada y perdón, y gracias por la paciencia. Sí, nomás quería como cerrar el evento y agradecer a todos los panelistas que fueron parte del evento, los periodistas que están aquí. Perdón si no llegamos a sus preguntas, pero aquí les pongo en el chat. Si tienen cualquier pregunta, lo pueden mandar a press@alianzaamericas.org y los podemos conectar con los panelistas si tienen algunas otras preguntas, si querían hacer una entrevista, lo que sea. Pero nosotros usualmente cuando hacemos nuestros eventos, cerramos con un call to action. Así que les estamos pidiendo y agradeciendo a todos los participantes que nos están llegando a través de Facebook también, que pueden mandar la palabra salud al 225568 en su teléfono para aprender más sobre todos los esfuerzos que hemos hablado de hoy y accesar recursos para mantener a nuestras comunidades bien saludables. Así que muchas gracias por estar aquí y nos vemos muy pronto y muchas gracias de nuevo. Hasta luego todos.